हेलो एवरीवन, आई एम सनद।
एंड आई एम श्रुति एंड वी आर गोइंग टू बी योर होस्ट फॉर टुडे फॉर द सेवेंथ एपिसोड ऑफ आर पॉडकास्ट सीरीज एंड इनिशिएटिव बाय एलुमनाई रिलेशंस टीम। आई वुड रिक्वेस्ट यू ऑल टू लाइक दिस पॉडकास्ट, फॉलो अस ऑन इंस्टाग्राम एंड शेयर दिस विद योर फ्रेंड्स ऑन व्हाट्सएप। एंड आई टेल यू वाई, बिकॉज टुडे वी हैव विद अस समवन विद अ रिच एक्सपर्टाइज इन मार्केटिंग अक्रॉस वेरियस प्रेस्टिजियस ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस। Today, we are going to talk in depth about how brands are leveraging the power of social media. It is a matter of immense privilege to talk about this with Mr. Archit Sureka, who has had a diverse experience of working with different FMCG companies and is now working with Facebook. I'm sure the conversation today is going to be very interesting to a lot of our listeners, as well as because we are going to get a sneak peek into the world of marketing and how social media is changing the landscape of digital marketing. Hello, Archit, and welcome to our podcast.
Hey, hi, Shruti. Hi, Sanad. Great to talk to you. And, you know, it gives me immense pride in seeing how my college, my alma mater, SEMHRD, is evolving over time. I keep bumping into people from SEMHRD and they are in great places in their personal and professional life. And it only gives me more and more pride every time I meet someone. So thanks for keeping the flag flying high.
Great, great. Okay. So to begin with, we want to really know, can you talk about your current role as a client partner in Facebook and how your experience in diverse sectors helping you in this role?
Yeah, sure. Why not? So my role as a client partner at Facebook primarily entails me driving the growth agenda for some of our key client relationships we have at Facebook. So, you know, some of the largest advertisers in the country, they get managed from Facebook, and I'm a person from Facebook who looks after them. And with my experience of having spent, say, over 10 years in various FMCG companies like Kellogg, GSK, L'Oreal, across sales and marketing functions, you know, the clients I manage also happen to be from the CPG vertical, because the company wants to tap into my knowledge of having worked in FMCG to consult them.
Okay.
Yeah. And, you know, having like, you know, the firsthand knowledge of the challenges and priorities of a brand manager, like, you know, that go into driving success factors for the brand actually gives you the right skill set to be the person from Facebook to come and advise. Because, you know, if you don't have this kind of an experience, you wouldn't know what are the brand and category dynamics at play, and you wouldn't be able to form a robust marketing plan. And my job is to consult from Facebook on how do you leverage our platform and the solutions that we offer for the brands. And hence, having an in-depth understanding of what happens in an FMCG is really, really important.
Right.
Right. Right.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's just a quick gist about what I do.
All right. All right. Great. So moving on, sir, you have a sprawling career in FMCG in industry before joining Facebook. So changing from a kid's breakfast, you know, to oral care, to beauty products, and now as a client partner, what challenges did you face, you know, during this amazing journey?
Yeah. Well, to be honest, I had fun in every single stint of mine and have learned quite a lot. As you would imagine, like, you know, every category comes with its own set of challenges, and solving for these challenges is what keeps you growing and keeps you going as a marketer. You know, to shed some light and share some experiences across companies, let me probably start with how I started on Chocos, which is the kids portfolio at Kellogg, right?
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So there on Chocos, like a primary KPI or a thing that I was tasked with was to drive up kids' pester, right? So driving up this pester power of the brand would be a critical success factor for the brand, right? So we would always be looking at, okay, what is the next big superhero movie releasing, whether it is a Batman, a Spider-Man, or a Superman film on that brand Chocos could associate with, and then give out freebies with that. You know, so kids would be really, really intrigued with collecting cards, tattoos, stickers. And, you know, even that would form like such a strategic part of a brand growth that, you know, we would always be on a hunt that, hey, what is the next big association I can do with my brand? And get more and more kids to try the category, because once they come and try the product, we were pretty certain that they would stick onto it. It was just about getting that first trial going. So that was, say, what was happening at Kellogg. talking about Sensodyne, it's a world of a difference, right? Moving from a breakfast cereal company to a healthcare company, just the fundamental codes of the company change. And the brand Sensodyne, it's one of the biggest success stories in the Indian FMCG space that have happened in the last few decades. Like, you know, it's a oral care brand that has come out of nowhere in a company which is not known for oral care and still established itself as a formidable player.
Right.
So on Sensodyne, it was all about expertise, right? We were a small challenger brand, not known to anyone in country, and taking on the behemoth Colgate, right? Colgate had the dominant position. They would have, say, 50-55% plus market share. And there were enough and more examples in the market where companies like P&G tried to launch Crest or Oral-B toothpaste in India and didn't succeed because of the position that a Colgate and even Unilever brand like Pepsodent and Close-Up would hold. So, you know, we came out with a very single-minded focus that we will establish ourselves as sensitivity expert. We aren't playing in too many oral care categories or need states that exist. And our single-minded agenda was we are the sensitivity expert. So for everything else on oral care, you can go to the regular brand that you go to. But when it comes to sensitivity, which is a serious problem, or you would have heard the word daanton mein jhanjhanahat, which has gotten added to people's vocabulary by seeing the Sensodyne dentist ad, right?
Right.
Agree.
So people have seen the boring dentist ad, but it is that boring dentist ad, which is a real dentist, right? An Indian dentist is not even allowed to endorse a brand, and hence we would go all the way to UK, find Indian dentists working there and get them to be the endorser of the brand. And it would not be an ad that is shot with a script, right? Typically, you would script an ad. But what we would do is to keep it authentic, to keep it real. It would be just an interview that you would do with the dentist that, hey, what do you recommend when it comes to sensitivity? What brands do you use? What happens in sensitivity? Okay. And then just cut that conversation into an ad and play it on TV. Yeah.
Amazing.
So it's a very, very different space. And that authenticity is what really works for the brand. So the only battle, if at all, Colgate has ever lost in the oral care space, it is this battle of sensitivity.
Sensitivity.
Yeah. So that's like, you know, the amazing place of Sensodyne. Moving on, L'Oreal, again, I would say it's again a leap, and no two companies, no two brands work alike. And at L'Oreal, it's all about beauty, right? Where at L'Oreal, the imagery of the brand and its stature in the minds of consumers is far, far larger than the brand's turnover or market share. Like, you know, people really adore, idolize and look up to products and brands that L'Oreal as a company owns. And hence, the whole attention at L'Oreal is, you know, on these finest of the details or the smallest of the nuances of how do you want to depict the brand? How do you want to showcase the brand ambassador? Or how a display in a retail outlet for L'Oreal would be? Like, you know, imagine a hair care ad that you're working on to create, and every single strand of hair that is being shown on the face of the celebrity is getting fixed. Like, you know, shade of the color that, hey, is this looking a little too black? Is it looking a little too brown? Is the skin looking perfect, or is it too perfect? And hence I want to keep it a little real. So these attention to minutest of the details that, you know, you or any end consumer wouldn't even think so much about would be thought through and debated at length, because, you know, if you are a brand which is built on imagery, consumer is buying into that imagery and not really the product, right? A shampoo might in itself not be something that, hey, I want to clean my hair and hence I'm buying a shampoo. They are buying into the brand L'Oreal, and hence they want the whole experience to go with it.
Exactly.
So it's the imagery that is getting built and that is getting bought into. So that was just like, you know, a bit about L'Oreal. And coming to Facebook, that again, as different as it can be, and it really is about pace and the speed of things here. Like, you know, I would say if all FMCGs work at X being the speed, Facebook works at 10X that speed. Like, you know, because it is such an agile organization. And here, like, the company philosophy is our journey is just 1% done. Like, you know, even after being there for so long, being at the edge of digital transformation in the world, we always say that whatever we do, wherever we, whatever we have achieved, we are just 1% done. You know, a big difference is all the information and tools in the company are available at the click of a button. The biggest challenge a traditional FMCG company would face is that, hey, what did I do, say, 5 years back or whatever history I have traveled with my brand? There might be someone who might come and say that, hey, let's try this. And the whole team might go after it without having the learnings and results of what has happened in the past available with them very readily. Whereas Facebook, it really prides itself in having the information democratized and available to everyone. So if I'm going and saying something about Facebook and using Facebook or Instagram or WhatsApp to my brand manager in India, it will probably be the same thing that is happening in US or in Europe at the same time. So it's such a unified system that, you know,
right,
if Instagram Reels is a thing that is getting popular in India, I am continuously sharing learnings of how this tool is getting used by brands with my counterparts in Singapore, in London, in US. And, you know, everybody is using it, learning it and sharing their learnings. So this cross-pollination and fast sharing of learnings, it what really makes it a technology company, behemoth, so to say, and an agile organization that it is. So that's from the work. But, you know, one more nuance of the work is basically the company's culture. You know, it's not just the product and categories that bring you diverse learnings.
Right.
It's exactly. Also like the culture, like, you know, an American company like a Kellogg or Facebook is very different fundamentally in how it behaves and works than a British company like GSK or a French company like L'Oreal. You know, the culture of the country also comes into the way things, ways of working that are defined and decided. And that in itself is an amazing learning experience. So, you know, even that I would want to call out.
Right.
Yeah.
Great. That was some, you know, great insights there, sir. I could recollect the memories of, you know, when I was, you know, young and I was, you know, going out to collect those cards, like you mentioned about Kellogg's.
Yes.
And, you know, the Sensodyne factor too. And then Reels, everything that you said was really, really great. And I could really connect with it. So some super. Really great insights there. Right. So let's move on to the next question. So what type of roles do you see, you know, getting more and more prominent within organization as technology shapes the way we work and engage with the customers?
Yeah, a really interesting question, I must say, you know. So the world, as you rightly captured, is becoming more and more digital every day, right? The pace of this change is only accelerating. And, you know, with everyday connectivity improving, access to devices like mobile phones and laptops getting democratized and people across pop stratas, it's no more an urban phenomena to have a 4G mobile phone, right? Like, smartphones are available in smallest of the nooks and corners of the country. And who would have thought like a year back that, you know, you could work continuously for 10 months from home, this work from home life and counting, right? It's not yet over. For all you know, another 6 months could be there that you have to still work from home without even going to office for a single day. Like, you know, there were people who would say that, hey, I can meet only in person. I cannot do a call. And all those meetings are now happening virtually. It's the availability of this high-speed internet and devices and services like a WhatsApp, a Zoom call, a Microsoft Teams that have made it possible. So with this rapid change, right, and this is while COVID-19 has only pushed it faster, these things were anyways evolving.
The
single largest thing that, you know, gains prominence is the agility, right, of a professional and the organization that is put to test. So whether you are into sales or marketing, HR or finance, operations or strategy, every role is evolving with time, right?
Correct.
It's no single role that is not getting impacted that, hey, I am more secure in marketing while sales is getting disrupted. Finance is an option of choice, whereas operations I could probably not choose. All of it is getting disrupted. And if you are a professional who can continuously learn and learn to collaborate with others in the organization, then you are set up for success. Right. So honestly, if you were to ask me to, you know, say that, hey, these kind of roles are getting more importance or prominence, I would say there is great demand for good people in every single function of the company, right? You just need to be good at what you're doing, and you should be able to continuously learn and evolve. Great people are valued in every single function. So whatever be your calling, just go after it and be the best in it is what I would say.
Okay, great answer. Recently Cadbury, with the help of Facebook, came up with hyperlocal ads, you know, in a way to show support towards the local retailers. So why do you think are the future possibility of such hyperlocal ads, and can it be transformed to hyper individualized ads on Facebook using AI and, you know, very personalized things which we see nowadays?
Yeah, again a great example. And the ad or the campaign that you're talking about is not just a Cadbury ad, right? Which was played around Diwali.
Yes.
Yeah. It's definitely a path-breaking campaign, which has been the talk of the town. And I'm sure like a lot of people have seen it forwarded on WhatsApp or seen it.
Yes.
And that's the power of great communication and an idea. So honestly, if you ask me, hyperlocal ads are not something that has that have happened just now. You can go back that, hey, a new McDonald's store opening in your vicinity, and you would see pamphlets getting thrown around to your houses saying that, hey, there is a store near your home. And that is the oldest example of hyperlocal advertising, right? A new store in your vicinity announcing to their catchment area. But what really technology does to this is provide this great scale and ease of execution. Right. Now, it is not restricted to a certain area only. I can do this for thousands of localities, of thousands and thousands of pin codes across India. And this is all made possible by digital, right? Because we know that what location you as a consumer could potentially be from, and where are you interacting? What are your interest areas? And the platform gives this power to advertising. So it's a combination of advertising or a creative idea and marrying it with great digital tools that are available. So an advertising product from Facebook that exists today is called DCO, or Dynamic Creative Optimization. Now, just to tell you without getting into too many technical details, is this basically gives you power to make a unique ad for every individual. So like you were saying, Shruti, is there possibility of hyper-individualized ads? Very much. What happens in this is you, every part of the ad that is there, say for example, a headline, an image, a body copy, every single part is broken down into parts, and you as a brand or as an advertiser can put in multiple options and iterations of each, that, hey, these are the different combinations of 100 headlines that I want. These are the 50 different images that I probably want to show. And these are the different copies of text that I have. And you leave it to the system, and the machine learning algorithm actually works basis an interest. So if I am, say, again, a retailer, a new shop owner, an ad that will get shown to Shruti could have a headline which says that, hey, girl, new collection in town, come and visit our store, with an image of a girl, and it appeals to her. And at the same time, the ad that gets shown to Sanad could have that, hey, guy, here is the coolest winter collection for you, with an image of a man probably in the right age group that will appeal to Sanad, with the text around the choices and interests that the machine has been able to figure basis how Sanad interacts with his friends, family, or the kind of content he browses.
Absolutely.
And you just set up one single ad that, hey, I want the headline to come here, I want the image to be shown here and like this, and you leave it to the system, and that is what the possibility is. And that's exactly how Cadbury's leveraged that, hey, there are these pin codes. In these pin codes, there are these shops that I have a optical optician in this area. I have a grocer in this area whose name is this. And when I'm showing this ad in this particular pin code, say there are 100 pin codes in Mumbai, and in this particular area, people will see Raj Optics. People will see Vijay Kirana stores. People will see the names of outlets in their area. And hence, you make thousands of combination of these ads, and different ads are shown to different people.
Okay.
So So that's really the power. It ultimately needs a great idea. Technology just enables it.
Right.
Sometimes I feel if now, I sometimes think and that the ad comes on Instagram.
Yeah.
I also
people have this feeling that, hey, was somebody listening to me? Is it reading my mind? But honestly, it is not. It is just your great everything that you interact with gives the system a signal. Say if you read an article sometime or your friend did something and system thinks that, hey, you might also be interested in it because it is your friend or family. It is just it's better prediction based on what it gathers from you. And then it shows, and sometimes it is this serendipitous discovery that feels that, hey, has it read my mind? But it is actually you giving signals to the system and system predicting, okay, you might like this. Let me show it to you. It's just that.
Right. Okay. Very well explained as to, you know, how the digital curve is shaping our lives. So a great explanation. So let's move on to a bit of, you know, academics related question. So do you think it's necessary for any marketing student to take up a sales role in the beginning, irrespective of any other marketing field he or she wants to diverge in later?
All right. So this, I think, is one of the most asked questions by anyone into sales and marketing, right? You know, as a student, is it important? And, you know, to give you a disclaimer at the start, there is no right or wrong answer to it. I will say it from my experience, and you know, it is very, very individual. See, how I see it is field sales or the sales organization forms the foundation of an FMCG company. So again, I will be talking from the FMCG perspective. People's perspective might change when it comes to, hey, sales and marketing, when it comes to a financial organization or an automobile company, or, you know, there could be other verticals where sales and marketing plays a different role. But when it comes to FMCG in particular, if I were to say it, here, see, companies' core revenue generating operations happen from the field sales, right? So in a way, it forms one of the most critical functions. While a lot of companies honestly give you the opportunity to start directly with marketing, right? I remember P&G would hire people and offer them that, hey, we are hiring you specifically for marketing and we are hiring you specifically for sales. So that would be decided at the time. What I felt basis my experience of starting as an ASM in Orissa, Jharkhand, Bihar, in Kellogg is worth its weight in gold. The experience of working alongside a sales rep, going into the market every day, and then planning for the whole team. Okay, what could be the monthly target that you could achieve by brand, by outlets, only makes you a better marketer tomorrow. Because once you know and appreciate these operational challenges, tomorrow when you're making the marketing mix for your brand, you would understand these challenges and nitty-gritties that, hey, while this looks great on a presentation, this looks good for my brand sitting in the head office, but will a field sales guy be able to execute it? Will a retailer be able to talk about it the way I want it? And will a consumer even understand what I'm trying to do? Hence, just having that understanding is really, really important. And I have enough and more friends who started from marketing and then said that, hey, because I've not worked in sales, I came to you to discuss this. You probably have a better POV. So that being, like, you know, my particular experience, but a word of caution here, you should pursue the area of interest and not follow the herd. Like, you know, a lot of teams, we say that, hey, I want to do this, but, you know, I don't think this is right. Everybody is doing this and hence I will follow that.
Right.
If you as an individual have clarity that, you know, sales is definitely not my cup of tea, come what may, I never would like it or I wouldn't enjoy it, then you might be better off starting in an organization that is offering you a role in marketing from the very start, rather than, you know, you joining something and then saying that, hey, I'm not enjoying it. Let me look for a job change or let me look for a quick change into the role. So if you have that clarity, definitely start off with the right plan. Because I would tell you that, you know, there are always possibilities of moving between marketing and sales at any stage of the career. So some people say that, hey, once if I start in sales, I will not be able to get into marketing and vice versa. I have seen people having spent 8-10 years in marketing and going back to sales And sales these days is not just, you know, field sales. There are like really, really very close role, bridge roles, which could be trade marketing. E-commerce has come up as a big thing. Modern trade, you know, is amazing thing. So, you know, every small aspect of sales has gotten evolved. So I would say that, you know, try out your hand at both the things. A lot of people in B schools, when they are learning and going through the books, they feel that, hey, I want to do marketing. Whereas they might actually, when they join the company and start doing it, decide that, hey, no, I enjoy sales more and I would build a career here. So definitely try, explore it for yourself and then take a call is how
I would see it. So as to make a well-informed decision rather than, you know, has.
And, you know, summer internship actually is a great point to sample this, right? You get 2 months of no commitment, so to say, long-term decision-making. So use the summer internship as a great way to sample that. Hey, you did a 2 month stint. Typically, summer interns, half of them might be in sales, half of them might be in marketing. So try out if you could get your choice of role and do it in the couple of months of summer internship in that function. And then, you know, you are better informed in the final placements time that, hey, I tried it. Did I enjoy it or no?
That's a great, great explanation.
Great. So moving to our last question, I want to know one piece of advice from you that you would want to give to all our listeners and especially our friends who are going to be future marketeers. And, you know, we really wish to work in FMCG and such great organizations. So just one piece of advice which you want to give.
Okay. So no, you know, big words of wisdom, but, you know, some basic piece of advice that has, you know, helped me keep going is, I would say, is have a learning mindset and keep trying out different things. Because, you know, large companies and typically the ones that come to B schools for placements, they really, really value fresh talent. They come to you and they want you in the organization because, you know, they appreciate a diverse and a different perspective with this fresh thinking that you come to the organization, right? Every organization is saddled with challenges and problems that they're trying to solve. And with this fresh perspective that you people just coming out of colleges, you help solve these problems better. Like, you know, someone wouldn't have even thought about the solutions that, you know, a noob in the organization can suggest. So, you know, come with that fresh perspective and always have a POV. Because, you know, ultimately, a lot of times people think that, hey, I'm the junior most in the room. I should probably just keep quiet and, you know, not speak my mind. I would say always have a POV. And, you know, you are being paid to have your point of view and then be very articulate about putting across your point of view. Because, you know, never think that, hey, it's okay to commit mistakes. It's okay because, you know, the more mistakes you do early, the better person you will be later on with having handled those situations. So having that POV expressing yourself is an important thing. And second thing, as a tip on an important skill that has become like really, really critical for everyone's success is collaboration and collaboration across cross-functional teams. And, you know, I remember from my day at SAMHRD that, you know, there used to be learning groups and you would be made into a team of six people and all the assignments and projects had to be done. You know, that pretty much is everyone's work life that, you know, you will have to collaborate with different people and different teams to deliver on a project. And there will never be two people with similar mindset or two people with similar pace of work. And everyone will have their own priorities and ways of working.
But exactly.
Working through those and solving for those, you know, project deliverables is what really brings success. That's like, you know, my two bits for everyone listening to this podcast.
Amazing. That was really nice.
It really feels like, you know, this is the time to, you know, do whatever things that we can. And this is the time to, you know, grab as many suggestions as we can so as to, you know, shape our better life for ourselves. So that's really great insight there from you.
Yep. All the best, guys. Have fun. I would say that, you know, just have fun while you learn. And these days, I would tell you that, you know, most memorable days in your life will be your days from your B school. So please have fun because you will get into the grind and you will miss and remember these days.
For that, we have to go to college, which we are
hopefully
hoping very soon.
So that was really an insightful and interesting session with you. all of us are always very curious as to, you know, how it is to, you know, with working with such a big brand. So thank you for giving us a sneak peek into it and taking out time for this episode on a Sunday evening, right after your meeting. So we're really grateful for this, and it was a pleasure to have you with us. I'm looking forward to more such engagement. So thank you, Archit, for this wonderful episode.
Thank you. The pleasure is all mine. All the best, guys.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Archit.